Good morning, Sir Mike and Ma'am Nikki. Good morning to all the televiewers.
All right, Commissioner, for the benefit of our viewers, let's give them a sense of what a statement of contribution and expenditures is, or SOCE. What is it supposed to contain? What's the purpose?
Well, a SOCE is a sworn statement of how much a candidate had spent during the campaign period. Take note that the campaign period for national position is 90 days and the campaign period for local position is 45 days. Under the law, a candidate for president is supposed to spend only 10 pesos per registered voter, regardless as to whether this candidate is a political party or no political party. But an ordinary candidate lower than the position of president, from senator down and vice president, from senator down to the last councilor, can spend only 3 pesos per registered voter if with a party. Without a party, they are supposed to spend 5 pesos per registered voter, and a political party and party list organization can spend only 5 pesos. They cannot go beyond that limit. That's why the SOCE will reveal to us how much a candidate has spent, whether the candidate had overspent, or we will also determine who gave contributions or donations to these candidates or political parties. And at the same time, we will find out whether there are certain donations or amount given to them which were not spent, or whether they had paid the proper taxes corresponding to the expenses that were incurred during the entire campaign period. So I would like to point out that those candidates who withdrew before the campaign period will not file SOCE anymore, because of the decision of the Supreme Court in the case of Piñera versus Comelec, that these candidates are not yet considered the candidates before the start of the campaign period. However, if a candidate will withdraw during the campaign period, 90 days and 45 days, and at the same time, whether they will win or lose, they still have to file their SOCE.
Commissioner, before we go to the details, I just want to ask, for the benefit of our viewers as well, what are the consequences for non-filing of SOCE? And has this been enforced?
Yes, Sir Mike. Non-filing of SOCE, well, we have been enforcing that several elections ago, and we had been saying that if you will fail to file your SOCE, you will be charged with a case, and at the same time, you will be required to pay a fine. At the same time, if in case a candidate will fail to file SOCE for 2 consecutive elections, say in 2019 and in 2022 this time, then they will be perpetually disqualified to hold public office, meaning that they cannot accept appointive or elective position after that. That's why that is actually the consequence of non-filing for 2 consecutive elections. However, likewise, if a candidate will misrepresent or will wrongly file the SOCE, then that candidate will be facing an election offense, 1 to 6 years imprisonment, and at the same time, a case for perjury under the revised penal code.
And when we talk about contribution and expenditures, Commissioner, what's the scope of the kind of expenses, contributions that should be declared? Because, for example, there's no doubt TV ads should be included, but will this also include ads on the internet as well?
Yes. Well, as far as contributions, donations are concerned, under Comelec Resolution 10730, we laid down and we likewise included a list of those entities which cannot contribute. Like, for example, an entity which has an existing franchise with the government, they cannot contribute. As far as corporations are concerned, we came up with a resolution saying that they can only contribute not more than 5% of their taxable income for the previous year before the donation. Now, if just in case a candidate had spent something for broadcast or in the social media, likewise, networks will have to submit before the commission election the list of advertising contracts and such other related matters, including individual contractors such as the social media net companies. They will have to submit to Comelec so that we can compare their submission as against the submission of the candidates. There was one candidate before, if we can still remember, a candidate for governor of a province, a very big province, that was disqualified by the commission election because of when the SOCE submitted before the Comelec was compared to the submission of several networks, it would appear that the SOCE lacks this information, and therefore the SOCE does not really reflect the expenses incurred by this candidate during the campaign.
Thank you, Commissioner. Of course, it's easy to track ads on TV or traditional networks. But what about social media? Because your guidelines do require social media influencers to report anything that has been spent in connection with the elections. But what if they don't report and the candidate as well do not report? Do you have a means of actually finding out if there were such arrangements between a social media influencer and a particular candidate?
We would like to readily admit that because of the absence of a law regulating social media in the Philippines, that the COMELEC is really powerless, at least to monitor what you have said. And that's the reason why in the next Congress, we will really push for a social media regulation, at least as far as election expenditure and campaign is concerned. That is really the problem, that sometimes and most often, social media influencers will not report to their books. And at the same time, the candidates will not report to their source. And so what can we do? What the only thing that we can monitor perhaps is when a candidate will boost their social media account with the company, like for example with Facebook or Twitter, mm-hmm. and in that case we can require Twitter or Facebook to submit to us the candidates that boosted their social media accounts. But as far as other contracts are concerned, then the comment will be in the dark, and it will be very, very difficult indeed to find this out and determine who is actually telling the truth or not.
Is this also true, for example, for artists who endorse a particular candidate? I mean, some could claim that they are not paid, that they're doing this for free, but there are those who are accused of receiving millions in cash or millions for endorsing a particular candidate. Is there a way for the COMELEC to look into this if the artist and the candidate do not divulge this?
Yes. Well, if there is a contract, then we can trace perhaps the contract, or in case the artist would be submitting before the Bureau of Internal Revenue a income tax return, and the income tax return will reflect an income pertaining to that particular candidate or expense pertaining to what the candidate spent for this artist, then that's the only way by which we can really monitor. So meaning to say, it takes two to tango. We respectfully request the artist to at least give us the total picture, the complete picture of what really was spent by the candidate, so that we can compare with the candidate. But unless and otherwise that thing will happen, definitely, Sir Mike, that is the loophole of our existing regulation as far as the social media influencers and artists are concerned.
And really the question of enforcement, Commissioner Garcia, because what about social media trolls as well? There are allegations of the social troll network operating on social media. This is, of course, an underground movement, right? You don't expect contracts to be signed with trolls. So what can be done at this point with respect to that?
Yes, we have an existing law, the Cyber Republic Act 10175, the Cyber Libel Prevention Act, but it's a very difficult really to prove and prosecute and enforce this law. But at the same time, again, we will push Congress to enact a law specifically for the campaign, specifically the use of trolls during the campaign period. Easily, anybody who will be victimized by these trolls can file cases in relation to cyber libel. But of course, it's very difficult to prove. At the same time, it's very difficult to pinpoint the liability of individuals in this case.
Mm-hmm. And what about expenses by volunteer groups who self-organized and contributed their own resources to put up a campaign rally, for example, or distribute campaign merchandise like t-shirts? Is the candidate required to account for all of these, even if the candidate might not be able or might not be aware the full extent of these contributions?
Yes, as far as these are concerned, then we cannot include that in the statement of contribution expenditure of candidates, definitely, because these are given for free by volunteers and the efforts of the volunteers. Then we cannot take that against the candidate, definitely. And if we are going to do that, then volunteers in the futures may refrain from even contributing or doing something for on behalf of their candidate. So that these are not included as far as statement of contributions and expenditures submitted by candidates are concerned.
Commissioner, from your point of view as a former election law practitioner and as a COMELEC commissioner, what laws or regulations are needed in the future to be able to govern and ensure that we have a level playing field for all candidates running for any elective post, especially in this age of social media and fast evolving technology?
Number one, we have to be realistic. We have to increase the number of the expenses that a candidate can spend for a voter, simply 10 pesos, that is not reasonable, that is no longer practical at this point. That is the price as of 10 or 15 years ago. Now, number two, we have to enact social media regulation in the Philippines, at least as far as election and campaign is concerned. And number two, we really have to strengthen the prosecutorial arm of the Commission of Election as far as going after those who are hiding the truth as far as reporting their real contributions and expenditures are concerned. We should be given more teeth to prosecute these individuals, not only individuals or candidates, but also political parties and contributors.
Commissioner, let me go to other COMELEC matters or election matters. What happens now to those petitions seeking to stop the proclamation? Now that the president and vice president have been proclaimed, can they be considered moot already by the Supreme Court? Or can the Supreme Court still look into the allegations of disqualifications that are mentioned in the petitions?
Without particularly referring to the cases or case that you mentioned, just a general rule, there is a decision by the Supreme Court in the case of Reyes versus the Commission of Election, which says that the jurisdiction of a particular body in this case, the Supreme Court, or in other cases, the Commission of Election, will not cease to exist until the candidate had been, number one, proclaimed, had taken his oath, and number three, had assumed office. So meaning to say, when you say assumed office, it would appear to be up to June 30 of 2022, because that is when an elected official elected by May of 2022 will assume office. So the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court or the COMELEC or whatever body remains as of this time.
Commissioner, what has happened to your investigations of alleged electoral fraud or instances where there are supposedly irregularities in the conduct of elections? Have you been able to conclude your investigations, and how many are we talking about?
Yeah, well, in the case of vote buying, we have almost 1,000 cases being investigated, and we have several subpoenas issued requiring the respondents to explain. In the case of disqualification cases involving practically the same fraud and irregularities, the cases are now submitted for resolution after the respondents were required to file their answer. Well, now, in the case of other fraud that you have mentioned, like, for example, the presence of this garbage in certain in one area in Cavite, and the data breach that happened. These are ongoing investigations, but definitely I can promise you we will come up and we will be very open and transparent to reveal to the public what happened and transpired in these investigations.
And Commissioner, any concerns raised about the electronic voting or the automated voting that we conducted? Because there are claims of so-called electronic vote shaving, but have you been able to receive complaints about this?
Nothing at all, Sir Mike. As far as we are concerned, as far as being supported by our initial result for the random manual audit, and likewise from the PPCRB, the Citizens Arm of the Commission of Election, we were able to achieve a 99.97% accuracy rate. So meaning to say, from the president down to the last councillor, that was revealed in our audit. And this audit findings were participated by several credible individuals and organizations. So at least these are all allegations of vote shading and the vote adding. But until today, we have not proven that.